Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hello, you've just about made it. We are at the home stretch to the finish line in the TV Guidance Counselor Boston Marathon Marathon. I don't know why I just decided to name it the Boston Marathon Marathon right now on the last episode. But thank you for joining me today. I don't know if you've listened to all of these episodes. If you have, seriously, please email me and tell me you've done this. I will be shocked that anyone did this. But I cannot think of a better way to end this marathon today with one of my favorite guys in Boston. He sadly is retired from live performing for the time being, although he may come back. Mr. Chris Coxen. I've known Chris for about 10 years. Chris used to do a lot of really bizarre character comedy. Very, very funny. There's plenty of footage online for you to check that out. And he hung up his boots about a year ago performing live, but he has a great blog called Take the Patience, where he does some really, really funny cartoons. Chris is also one of those guys that is sort of a mystery to me because he's so manly. He just got back from being in South America for like 3 months. I once convinced Chris to move to the UK, and he got a part in an international Toshiba computer ad. Then he also got beat up by a gang of roving teenagers during the ill-fated riots of whatever year that was, August of 2012, when he was doing the Edinburgh Fringe Fest. So, you know, I guess it's a wash there. But Chris is really funny. I really always like talking to Chris. I don't see him nearly enough. And when I do, he always is always in a good mood. He's a great roller skater. Been to Roller Read many times. He also recently gave me a fantastic Sybil Shepherd LP. He's been on Last Comic Standing, you know. He's just a great guy. I'm sad that he doesn't perform live anymore, but I understand his choice. So here's our final episode of this little experiment, the TV Guidance Counselor Boston Marathon Marathon. We made it to the home stretch. Actually, are you actually running the marathon? I wonder if anyone actually running the marathon downloaded these shows and is listening to them as they run. That would be very, very strange and also highly unlikely. But anyway, here we go. The home stretch. You're over Heartbreak Hill into the finish line with our final episode for today with Mr. Chris Coxen. Mr. Chris Coxen, how are you, Chris?
I'm good, Ken.
Chris has raised his Smurfs mug of tea at me that I prepared for him.
This is my podcast mug. I wouldn't use this in public. I didn't think you were going to bring it up.
This is public, yeah. Well, no, I'm going to take a photograph of that mug.
Oh, you are?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I'm going to take a picture of you. What's wrong with that mug? It's got Vanity Smurf on it, and it says, I love me.
You know what? As you know, I was a big Transformer. I was in the Transformer camp, and I felt like if you were in that, you were not allowed to like Smurfs at the same time.
You think they were mutually exclusive? Yeah. I liked both.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, I, if you had Transformers toys, I would have talked to you. But otherwise, if you...
I might have a Transformers mug. I have Transformers on my fridge. Did you see? I have a big Decepticon.
Because all those... There's refrigerator Decepticons.
Yeah, I have a symbol, so it looks like my fridge is transforms into a Decepticon.
I have the same thing. I have both. I think the Decepticons are the freezer and the Transformers are the refrigerator.
So they've worked together like a Dinobot.
Exactly.
So, Chris, you've picked a TV guide from October 6th, 1984. Mm-hmm. What drew you to this TV guide?
I was definitely looking for mid-80s. I am I'm 40 years old, so the mid-80s for me would have represented the peak of my TV watching days.
Okay.
And October 6th was my birthday, so I would have just turned 11 years old.
So I have a theory, mm-hmm. and it's a psychological theory with no founding or research based on it, but that everybody's sort of favorite era of TV is from when they were about 8 to 12 years old. That sort of 4-year period seems to be the lays the groundwork.
Yeah.
Also, I'm sure it didn't hurt that the cover models are Terry Farrell and Morgan Fairchild of Paperdolls.
Yeah, I know what. I was more of a, maybe like a Lynda Carter.
Like the dark-haired beauties.
Yeah, I mean, and, you know, I liked some of the blondes, but those particular ones, you know, I didn't even know what their names were. But
well, Morgan Fairchild did used to date John Kerry.
Really?
And she was, when John Lovitz played his Tommy Flanagan liar character on Saturday Night Live the year after this, she was the one he always claimed to be married to.
None of that went into my decision-making, but it's all very good. And are you going to show this on the...
Yes, they'll see the cover of this, yes.
Yeah, man, there's some real, some amazing lighting going on.
Oh, yeah, it's very well lit. There's some good backlighting and some big 80s hair going on here. So, Chris, Saturday night, as all good TV guide weeks start, Saturday night, 8 o'clock, what'd you go with?
That was easy. Now, I mean, obviously, I was talking to you about this before, but a lot of these are... They under three categories: things I would have loved to watch at that age, things I would have watched at this age, and then ones that I would watch at either age would interest me. This one, I guess it's a little bit of both, but the 11-year-old me would have just jumped right at this. Airwolf.
You would have gone with Airwolf.
What's that?
You would have gone with Airwolf, no question about it.
There was simply nothing to compete. And I'm amazed because Saturday, 8 p.m., I thought there would have been something
else. So you weren't a T.J. Hooker fan?
No, no. And I never, it might have been a good show, but I never watched it.
I always found John Michael Vincent very, very off-putting. I never got that into Airwolf. This episode, on a secret mission behind the Iron Curtain. Yeah. All right, so I'm interested thus far.
Yeah.
Hawk loses control of the onboard computer, which was programmed on a timer by Airwolf's creator, Dr. Moffat, played by David Hemmings. So I'm happy to see a David Hemmings cameo. Mm-hmm. Now Airwolf is set to destroy any aircraft in its range.
I see, it's like, what is that, Superman 3 when he becomes evil? Or is that Superman 2?
Superman 2. Superman 3 is the one with Richard Pryor.
Yeah. Yeah, so Superman 2, like, he becomes evil for a little while.
Right.
So I love that.
You like the evil twin.
I like that whole going through, but then coming back, that Sid Arthur sort of thing at the end. And so, yeah, like,
Airwolf. Do you think Airwolf had a goatee in this episode? Because that's the indicator of evil.
Yeah, if they did, I didn't see it. It might have been like an infrared.
Well, because Knight Rider also had the evil version of Kit.
Oh yeah,
Car.
Yes, with we were discussing R's. This. Yeah. Yes, it's it's funny because Tony V, who's a Boston comic, I'm sure most of you guys know him. We're talking the other day about, you know what? I'm gonna save that because I'm gonna save.
Okay.
I'm gonna save
all right.
For
save that.
Yeah,
a little teaser.
Yes, exactly. Big teaser. But, yeah, I know Airwolf, the guy that is off-putting for you, say his name again?
Jan Michael Vincent.
And he was the younger straight
He's
brown.
Wolf, yeah. He's the guy that's not Ernest Borgnine.
Yeah,
He's the Michael Knight of Airwolf.
I agree. Like, he had those, like there was something, like, very
Squinty,
annoying.
Squinty, kind of, and he looked smarmy. Like he thought he was the shit.
Yes, yeah, very smarmy. Yeah.
And I've heard he's just a real asshole.
Really?
Yeah, he starred in a series of erotic thrillers in the 90s, like all Skinamax movies.
Really?
I think he had a drug problem. I don't know.
I didn't really give a rat's ass about him, but I loved the idea. You know what actually I preferred better than Airwolf was Blue Thunder.
Oh, Blue Thunder was much better.
Yeah.
Thunder was much better.
Yeah, and Airwolf, like, well, Blue Thunder's not on. I'll watch Airwolf.
Jim Michael Vincent was in one good movie. It was John Millais who did Red Dawn, and it was called Big Wednesday. Okay. I'm pretty sure it's Jim Michael Vincent. It's about a bunch of California friends who are surfers, and they're going to the Vietnam War, or it might be the Korean War. I haven't seen it in a while, but I remember liking that movie and liking him in that.
But wasn't this guy also in, like, it was either a made-for-TV movie or a series about, like, some post-apocalyptic...
America with 3 Ks?
And they were driving around in this crazy...
Oh, that's not a made-for-TV movie. That is a movie called... With they're in that truck, and there's the giant scorpions.
Yes. And there's a scene where cockroaches eat someone.
Yes. I cannot remember the name of the movie.
I can't even believe I've stumped
it. It's not Arc 2, which was a TV series using the same vehicle.
Okay.
I own this movie. I have it upstairs. We'll post it after, but I can't think of what it is off the top of my head right now.
I don't know things as well as you do, obviously, but I have visions, and I remember, like, I think that movie happened before Airwolf, no?
Yeah, well, absolutely. Okay. That That movie's from 79 or 80.
Okay, yeah.
It's on Blu-ray.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Well, I remember that vehicle just made, like, I love the idea of, like, the last survivors in this
amazing... In a camper van.
Yeah, I'm like, yeah. It's not so
bad. Did you ever see Arc 2? That was a similar vehicle. It was 70s. It was made by Filmation.
Okay.
It's not their best. It wasn't as good as Jason and Star Command.
No, I wouldn't, I wouldn't have expected it to be.
I definitely would not have gone with Airwolf on Saturday nights at this time. I would have gone with Different Strokes normally.
Yeah, I almost went with that.
But you did have a good point. Yeah. By 1984, Different Strokes was in syndication, so you probably could have seen reruns if you wanted to get your Different Strokes fix.
Yep.
This was towards the end of the series, but in this episode, Arnold and his pals think they have the perfect solution to contemplate classmate Lisa, contemptible classmate Lisa. They'll doctor her science experiment. And it's a Dudley episode. So anytime Shavar Ross comes in as Dudley, I remember I saw Friday the 13th Part 5. The New Beginning in the theater, and Shavar Ross is in it. It was around this time, I think it was about 84, and he's in peril at the end, and I remember this guy in the theater just goes, "No, don't kill Dudley!" And was like absolutely serious and sincere worrying about Dudley. Now, as I said, normally I would have watched Different Strokes, but this night on the Movie Loft, this is a Boston edition, WSBK TV 38, the Movie Loft, hosted by the great Dana Hersey, they were showing Race with the Devil with Peter Fonda, which is an excellent, excellent movie.
I've never seen it.
You'd like it a lot. It's 1975, I believe.
Nice. Okay.
And in this movie, I'll read you the description. Action melodrama about a satanic cult that turns a Southwestern holiday into a nightmare for two vacationing couples. So my dad loved this movie, and he made me watch it probably at this time. But Peter Fonda and his buddies, they're all vacationing. They witness a satanic sacrifice, and then the Satanists just chase them across the country.
Oh, man. All right.
Great movie. Now, 8:30, neither of us needed to pick anything because you picked an hour show. I'm going with the movie, but I will mention Give Me a Break was on, which I was a big fan of. This is Joey's failure to return from a night abroad.
A night abroad?
A night aboard. I'm sorry. A night aboard a ship makes it... Wow, that's even weirder. That makes less... A night abroad. You know, maybe he went to Canada.
I know, just for
but
one night.
Joey's failure to return from a night aboard a ship makes it no easier for Nell to consider Charlie's proposal. Yeah. Nell Carter sings Have I Stayed Too Long at a Fair, and when Joey Lawrence sings When the Saints Go Marching In, everybody loves it.
That was the first and perhaps only song I learned to play in the harmonica.
The Saints Go Marching In? That's the only song I can play on the piano.
Really?
My deaf grandmother taught me.
Well, that makes sense.
Yeah, yeah. So, 9 o'clock, what do you got?
Love Boat.
Love Boat. Now, I thought you would have gone with Partners in Crime, which, speaking of Lynda Carter, was her second series post-Wonder Woman.
Yeah.
I definitely would have gone with that. It was a great show where her and Lonnie Anderson team up. And this show is Carol is shocked to learn of the murder of an old friend, but she's even more shocked when Sydney takes on the prime suspect as a client. And so they were private investigators. Didn't last very long. Also, I should mention that Mickey Spillane's Mike Hammer with Stacey Keach was on, which was a good show as well, but I really did like Cover Up. And so Love Boat, this was sort of the tail end of Love Boat. This was the second to last season, I think.
Well, there's one person you'll probably know that like would have that would have made me want to watch it because it's so ridiculous.
Ted McGinley.
Nope.
So this is when Ted McGinley was on, and we'll read the thing here. Isaac and Gopher convince Ace, Ted McGinley, that he can impassion an old girlfriend, played by Jennifer Holmes, if he boxes the heavyweight champ, Dick Butkus. The father, James Noble, of a boy, Dick Billingsley, with a reading problem, refuses to believe his son may be dyslexic.
I don't care about that part.
What a boring story that is. An overbearing mother, Doris Roberts, from Everybody Loves Raymond, tells lies about her daughter, Tova Feldsha, hoping to impress a man with a secret of his own. That sounds kind of like a boring episode, aside from boxing Dick Butkus.
It's all the Dick Butkus thing.
I think you should do a one-man show called Boxing Dick Butkus. Somebody should.
Yeah, or an alternative, like very tortured folk alternative band.
Boxing Dick Butkus?
Yeah.
He was in a lot of TV at this time.
I know,
When did he stop playing football? I don't know anything about his football career.
In the 70s, he was with the Bears, and he was a lineman. I forget what position.
Is he dead?
I don't know.
He seems like someone who suffered a traumatic brain injury.
Or like a friggin' hamburger got clogged in his
aorta. Well, he was in My Two Dads.
Okay.
And he was on Growing Pains as well. He played Carol's boyfriend's father.
He was in other shows that I preferred that are like guest starring.
He was in a lot.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's what you went with. Yeah. You missed out on a couple good things, as I mentioned, Cover Up and Mickey Spillane. Also the show Rock in America, which was pretty terrible. So we move on to Sunday night, the day of our Lord.
Yes.
Chris Coxen, what do you got? 8 o'clock.
Knight Rider. And I loved Knight Rider.
You still do love Knight Rider.
Yeah. I Knight Rider was huge.
And this one, I assume you saw the ad for this episode in the TV Guide.
Yeah. Oh,
Michael
no,
enters
that.
A monastery.
Well, and here's, I don't know, do you want to read it? I wrote down the little bits of the plot line.
Yeah, you can go with it, and then I'll fill in the blanks.
Here are just a few phrases that totally titillate me here. Trailing diamond thieves.
Obviously.
That right there.
You don't hear a lot about diamond thieves that much these days.
No. I was in Thailand, and I met a kid from South Africa that supposedly smuggled diamonds.
Sounds like a liar.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. But it went good with my beer that I was drinking. But it's not only, he says trailing diamond thieves, but trailing diamond thieves in wine country.
Yeah, well, that's where they would go, obviously.
So these thieves are smuggling diamonds in wine country and using a monastery as a front.
What a perfect front. Yeah, I mean, no one's going to look for thieves or diamonds in a monastery.
Or in wine country.
There is a lot of, especially hour-long action dramas that end up taking place in a monastery. There's at least two episodes of MacGyver. There's an episode of Werewolf.
Okay.
There's an A-Team. But this one is one of the more ridiculous ones.
Yeah.
I'll read you what TV Guide wrote, although Chris summed it up very well there. Michael trails diamond thieves to wine country of Northern California, where the crooks are using a monastery as a front.
Not
great, but I would have watched it. Absolutely, that was really the only move at 8 o'clock.
That was and the thing I was going to mention before, so I was talking to Tony V and Mike Whitman Friday night, and we're talking about
I think you dropped something.
I know, Chris, there's a couple of names on the floor.
I
know I should probably get their permission for dropping their names.
We'll bleep it.
We're talking about how like ridiculous it was, like when they're, Michael went in and out of that car, the mobile unit. The truck. But he used
the
to go...
The Optimus Prime.
Yeah, the Optimus Prime of the Knight Rider saga. And how every time he went in or out of the truck was always moving.
Yeah.
Which was
an easy move.
Which was so stupid. Like, why didn't you just pull over and stop the damn truck?
Oh, that's action.
I know. But that was such an unnecessary thing. I loved it at the time. I still love it. But it's unnecessary.
When you're driving on the highway now, and you see one of those car carrier trucks, you know, the ones with, you know.
Yeah, I think of.
Do you always think of driving up there? Is there a single person on earth who isn't for a second tempted to just drive up right on the roof of one of those things?
Believe me, I've always wanted to.
I've gotten close a few times.
With my pickup truck, I want, there's a friend of ours, Barry Tattle, who rides around on a moped.
I should mention, Chris doesn't actually have a pickup truck. He has a van, but he calls it a pickup truck because he picks up ladies.
Yeah, exact. Good of you. And I want to drive. I want Barry to drive in it with his moped in the back like that.
That's an America's Funniest Videos waiting to happen right there. 9 o'clock. This is a tough one.
You're going to be upset with me with what I chose here. And I just want to preface this by saying that I don't give a damn about politics. But I think since I know who won the election, and if I were able to go back in time, I would enjoy it even more. The presidential debate at 9 p.m.
between President Ronald Reagan and Vice President Walter Mondale, Walter Mondale, who didn't have a chance in the world in this election.
Yeah.
So you would have watched that.
Yeah.
It seems boring.
Well, maybe not back then as a child. Although I always probably would have watched it because my dad would have been watching it.
Right, but you would find it interesting now to see, knowing what you know now.
Exactly.
See, I would have gone with Shirley Bassey.
Yeah,
the variety show.
That was the
which
other.
Which would have been much, much better. It had the 3 degrees, and they sang the song "Dirty Old Man."
Yeah, she did 3 James Bond songs.
Right.
So yeah, that was my second choice, but. If the presidential debate bored me, I would have flipped over to that.
Yeah, I mean, I have to imagine the presidential debate would have bored you. I mean, I can't listen to Reagan speak for more than 30 seconds without wanting to chew my wrists open.
But no one listened to him. They just looked at his hair.
He did have decent hair. Dude, I'll give him that.
Yeah, I mean, you of all people, like, you could do a Reagan
I could appreciate
haircut.
His hair. Yeah. I could appreciate his hair, but wow. Yeah. All right, Monday night, Chris, as I always mention, the saddest night of the week. You've gone back to school. You've gone back to work. You need something to take you away.
Well, I didn't really find anything at 8, but
really?
Just out of pure curiosity, I put down You Can Be a Star. I have no idea what it is.
You Can Be a Star. So You Can Be a Star is on the Nashville Network.
Which I didn't even have at that time.
The Nashville Network, I believe, is now Spike.
Really?
It transformed into Spike later, but it was the Country Music Network. It was a lot of episodes of Hee Haw. They had a show called Dance Night that was just country line dancing. And this was, if my memory serves me correctly, their version of Star Search.
Okay.
Very American Idol, but just singing country songs. Not a great show, not a great network. I can't believe you had difficulty at 8 o'clock when, number one, on TV 56, WLVI, you had the movie Portrait of a Stripper from 1979. Yep. It was a TV movie with the lovely Leslie Ann Warren as a stripper. It had Vic Tabak in it from Alice.
I don't
Alice.
Know either of those people. Oh, wait.
Leslie Ann Warren? You don't know? You'd recognize her.
Who was she? What was she in?
Leslie Ann Warren, you look her up. You'll recognize her. I don't want to ruin it for you. But Vic Tabak's from Alice.
Okay.
But what I definitely would have watched this night is, without a doubt, TV's Bloopers and Practical Jokes.
Yeah.
I'm surprised you didn't go with that.
Well, you'll see.
There's Practical Jokes on Charles Sibert, who's asked to help deliver a baby because of his medical background from Prepper John MD, and a joke on the Oak Ridge Boys, who try to cope with a confused interviewer. Also, Riptide Bloopers. And memorable World Series moments with Johnny Bench.
Yeah.
I mean, you're really missing out on that.
Yeah. No, I just feel like at that age, if I was, 11-year-old Chris, of course, I would have gone with the TV Bloopers.
Yeah, who doesn't love Ed McMahon?
Exactly.
Kids the world over loved Ed McMahon.
Yeah.
I want to see country singing. So what did you go with at 9?
At 9, Charlie's Angels.
This was really the tail end of Charlie's Angels. This is, So in this episode, a cat burglar is the prime suspect in the murder of a wealthy divorcee. This is Kate Jackson, Jacqueline Smith, and Cheryl Ladd era. Dirk Benedict is in this episode of A-Team, and Barry Bostwick from Rocky Horror, and he was also in Megaforce and Spin City.
Give me the name of the A-Team guy.
Dirk Benedict.
He was Face.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. From Battlestar Galactica.
Starbuck.
But you missed out on Kate and Allie, one of my favorite shows.
I didn't give a damn
this
about
was the
that
premiere
show.
Of season 2. As the series begins its second season, Kate listens with alarm to the ticking of her biological clock. At first, though, she's simply caught up in the excitement of a co-worker's pregnancy, as we all have been. Let's see. Then she discovers a physical yearning for someone little to take care of. Before long, Kate's taking her yearning so seriously that she considers having a baby, despite being single. Chris, I don't know why that doesn't sound interesting
to
you.
Well, Charlie's Angels, something about lovely ladies fighting crime.
Is better than a middle-aged woman trying to get pregnant?
Slightly.
Kate and Allie really is a good show. It's very funny and a very likable cast. It was too chick-centric for you?
See, I was pretty focused. Like, a lot of these, like, I didn't even watch Charlie's Angels that much. Like the ones, like Airwolf, Love Boat a little bit, Knight Rider, those are ones I really watched.
You used to sing the Love Boat theme at school every day, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
What was that about?
it started at a high school football game.
As all things do.
I know. It was Friday night under the lights, of course. And I went up to whatever you call the thing where they call the game.
The booth?
Yeah.
The announcer booth?
Yeah. But it was like this big barn building, and I was upstairs. And for some reason, I had been singing it like at my house or at parties just for...
Just because you liked it.
Yeah.
You're a big Jack Jones fan.
Yeah. And we had the music, or I just sang it a cappella at the middle of like either a soccer or football game.
Just out of nowhere. It took you over.
And then came Valentine's Day senior year, one of the two of high school. And I sang. So imagine it's 7:45, you're in homeroom, or 7:30.
Okay,
time.
I'm there.
And like, happy Valentine's Day, and then here's a special treat, and then I just sang Love Boat.
The entire song?
Yeah, on the intercom system.
Could you still do it? Do you remember the whole song
yeah.
now?
Oh, yeah. Oh, wow. I Barry Tattle, our friend, sings it sometimes, so he's, you know.
Yes, yes.
Reminded me of it, but.
And did people enjoy your singing of the Love Boat at school?
Yeah, oh, yeah, yeah. It was asked for. I never did it unless.
Did you do it at the prom?
No, I didn't. No, it wasn't. I don't think there was not a central moment or place that I could have done it.
I think you could have made it happen.
Yeah, I didn't want it bad enough.
Tuesday night, Chris Coxen, 8 p.m. What do you go with?
All right. Oh, well, all right. At 8 p.m., I had my first half-hour thing, which is like a rip-off of the other show we're talking about, Foul-Ups, Bleeps, and Blunders.
So you didn't watch Bloopers and Practical Jokes, yeah. but you went with Foul-Ups, Bleeps, and Blunders.
Yeah, just because at this age, I don't even remember watching that show, but it sounds like a crappy knockoff.
So if I put a Hydrox in front of you and an Oreo, which yeah. one would you pick?
Oh, I'm going to go with the JoJo's by Trader Joe's.
Well, natural. There's no JoJo's by Trader Joe's equivalent blooper show.
See, well, that's what I like, but that's why, like, since I'm not eating it, that's why the Foul-Ups one, just in this age, to go back and look at it, because be awful.
Oh, it is. In this yeah. episode, Inga Swenson from Benson, yeah. Yeah. An Olympic basketball star Cheryl Miller are the in-studio guests. Also, Noel Edmonds of Noel's House Party, yeah. very annoying guy, yep. of the BBC, introduces clips from abroad. I probably would have watched that every now and then, but that sounds yeah. pretty damn boring.
I know. No, it sounds bad enough to entertain me in this life or at this point in my life.
Now, on Showtime is what I would have gone with. Fairy Tale Theater was on, and with Shelley Duvall. And in this particular episode, they do The Nightingale with Mick Jagger starring. Mm. That would have been my move. 8:30, what'd you go with?
I didn't realize that this happened, that this changed name. Three's a Crowd.
Right, Three's Company became Three's a Crowd.
I had no idea.
So you've never seen Three's a Crowd?
I may have, and I didn't realize it. So was it just 1 year that it was like that?
It was 1 year, yep. So okay. Jack got married, and his okay. wife's father moved in with them, okay. and that was the crowd. Yeah. In this episode, after a month of living together, another of Jack's old-fashioned values surfaces. He thinks the man of the house should handle money matters. Getting an argument.
I know.
That's what you passed good. Up was the original ER. With Elliot Gould, the sitcom ER, which was a pretty fun show.
That did nothing for me.
I definitely would have watched that. 9 o'clock, what do you got?
And again, and this was on like every night, and there was nothing else to watch, but yet it was interesting. Hawaii 5-0.
My grandfather loved Hawaii 5-0. My grandfather was a very angry Norwegian man,
yeah.
and he pretty much sat at the kitchen table and smoked. And to the point where there was a nicotine ring on the ceiling.
Wow.
But he would get up out of his rage-filled depression occasionally to watch three things.
Yeah.
Hawaii 5-0,
mm-hmm.
People's Court, and Price is Right.
Wow.
And he called it that Hawaii program. Where is that Hawaii program?
This, I love the song is what really did it.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, the song's amazing. Dun, 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 dun. That was great.
I can play that on the guitar.
Can you?
Yeah.
All right. I trust you. And then the, just the whole being in Hawaii thing.
Have you ever been to Hawaii?
Yes.
It's great.
And I will, this will lead into a Thursday night choice that I made, but you know what? I'm gonna hold off.
So okay.
Spoil up that and, thing. But yes, I've been to Hawaii.
In this episode, well, people are in Hawaii every time they use my bathroom.
Oh, exactly. Yeah. I've noticed that. Yeah. You even have like a Hawaiian breeze coming out.
Oh,
of
yeah,
the floor.
Absolutely. We call it the Kona winds.
The Matt Kona winds.
Yes. Nice. Proceeding the trial of a band of vigilantes, the courthouse is endangered by a series of bomb threats. Not the best episode of Hawaii 5-0. It's not very tropical.
Do you remember it?
Yeah, I do remember okay. that.
I don't remember that episode, but
I definitely would have gone with our cover story show, Paperdolls, which was a drama.
Oh, yeah.
Dinah, played by Jennifer Warren, feels that Lori, Terry Farrell, is coming across too sophisticated during her first shoot for Wesley, played by one of my favorite named actors of all time, Mr. Dack Rambo. Do you remember Dack Rambo?
What was he in?
You need to look up Dack Rambo. He's going to be your new hero.
Well, you know the movie Rambo, why it was named Rambo.
From Dack Rambo.
No, because of the guy writing it, or the book, or whatever. It was Rambo apples. Rambos are a type of apple.
Well, the movie isn't called Rambo.
Oh, I know.
It's called First Blood.
Yeah, but the name of the guy, though.
Yeah, Rambo, John Rambo.
He got from Rambo.
Which they made a cartoon of, which was very, very strange. There was a children's Rambo cartoon.
When?
1987.
Okay.
But Paperdolls, so Dack Rambo.
Okay.
Taryn's insistence on going back to work may lead her part in a rock video. Blair, played by Mimi Rogers, Tom Cruise's ex-wife, tells the family she's pregnant, and David is pressured to repay his loan. Meanwhile, Racine, Morgan Fairchild, is interviewed for an expose about the fashion industry. Lloyd Bridges, Nicola Sheridan were also on the show. It didn't last very long. It was about models. I am obsessed with models.
Okay.
Love models, not in a lecherous way. I just love the world of modeling. I always found it interesting.
So do you like that, the
fashion photography?
The George Michael song.
Freedome 90?
Yeah.
Yeah, oh, I loved that video. Yeah. Absolutely. I could name every single model in that video.
I'm sure
I was
could.
I went to the model cafe and I was excited about it. I was sad to see it close. I don't know why I loved models so much.
Yeah.
Also loved the movie The Eyes of Laura Mars, which was about a fashion photography written by John Carpenter. Very, very good movie about models.
I've never seen this.
Also watched Models, Inc. and the spinoff of Who's the Boss about models that had Leah Remini in it.
Models, Inc.?
No, Models, Inc. wasn't, but there was a spinoff of Who's the Boss about teenage models with Leah Remini. Didn't last very long. So Wednesday night...
Before you go on, I feel like we have not overlapped on any... show choice.
No, neither. We have very different tastes. Chris and I are very, very... I don't think you could get two people who are more different than Chris and I.
Well, you know, the other thing, too, like, this would be easier and more interesting for me if we did, like, the after-school, like 3:30 to 5:30.
Maybe we'll do a special edition sometime, 3:30 to 5:30.
I mean, well, it's going to be Transformers, G.I. Joe every day, but there's
Probably have some overlap there, but Chris's... My house is filled with stuff. Yeah, like, you come in here, and I collect things.
Makes me nervous.
Yeah. You go to Chris's house, and there is nothing. There's not a book... There's not books. A movie.
There's books. No movies, though. Well, a few movies.
There's not a magazine. There's...
No.
Yeah,
no
nothing magazines. Is out on display.
I'm a Spartan.
Yeah, he's very, very... It's the exact opposite. We're the complete opposites in all ways.
Well, my parents' house is sort of not to that extreme. My friends called it the museum.
Just like in Ferris Bueller, it was very cold and you weren't allowed to touch anything?
There was warmth, but it was clean. It was always clean and orderly, which I love.
Well, my house is clean and orderly. There's just a lot of stuff.
Yes, I know. And it makes me nervous, all this stuff.
Yeah.
Man, I don't know how you do it. So this is what... This is Wednesday.
Wednesday night, 8 o'clock.
Wednesday at 8, you know, another easy choice. Actually, no, this was not an easy choice.
This was a tough one.
Yeah, but... I went with Fall Guy at 8 p.m.
I would have thought you would have gone with Fall Guy.
Couple reasons. I had a Fall Guy like toy set.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like a little like plastic jump in the plastic truck and you jump over barrels and
stunts.
Do stuntman thing.
Very popular at the time.
The plot line is very dark. And,
it was occasionally on the Fall Guy. This one, Jody, played by Heather Thomas of Zapped, is jailed for disturbing the peace by a county sheriff who sells female prisoners into prostitution.
Yeah.
That is dark.
Yeah.
And this also has a guest starring role by one of my favorite 80s action actresses, Sybill Danning, who I am Facebook friends with.
Explain who's Sybill Danning?
Sybill Danning's in The Howling Part 2.
That doesn't
Sisters of Werewolf. Sybill Danning is in Battle Beyond the Stars.
That also does not help me.
You should Google Sybill Danning. I should just give you a Google list.
The only Sybill I have room for.
Sybill Shepherd.
Exactly. Moonlighting.
Yeah, absolutely.
Why? Oh, was that already over?
No, Moonlighting hadn't started. I think Moonlighting started in 85.
Damn it, I grabbed the wrong... Yeah, that would have been... Yeah.
Moonlighting was great.
Yeah.
I would have gone with Charles in Charge. This was the first season of Charles in Charge. I understand your disgust.
Yeah.
But Charles, played by Scott Baio, encourages the kids to try extracurricular activities, but Jason, played by Michael Perlman, gets no kick from soccer, and Leela, April Lerman, who I had a crush on at the time, discovers she's far less perky than cheerleader Paula Thackeray, who was played by Olympic gymnastics medalist Julianne McNamara.
Barf.
Yeah. No, I understand. Charles in Charge is not a good show, and I watched it every week, even when it went into syndication, and I completely understand your disdain for it.
Yeah.
I would have had to go, but here's the good part, though. Mm-hmm. Because I picked a half-hour show,
yeah.
I have 8:30 open to me, and what I would have picked was a very short-lived comedy called The Dreams, and it starred John Stamos in a band, and Rita Wilson was in it, Mrs. Tom Hanks.
Okay.
And it also had, oh my God, I'm blanking on her name, Jamie Gertz.
Oh, wow.
And so in this one, a magazine article crediting Phil with making the band tick threatens his friendship with Gino, who is John Stamos' character, and Wiener, who is in the band, unwittingly becomes the missing link in a councilman's kickback scheme. They had original songs every week, and they would advertise the songs, and this week they say, featuring the song Kiss Me Red.
Wow.
I own the soundtrack to this show.
And that was one season?
Not even a full season. Yeah. But the soundtrack's not that bad. I have it on vinyl. We can, really? You and I can just sit and listen to it sometime,
I'd like
Chris.
That. I'd like that.
9 o'clock, what'd you go with?
9 o'clock? this is going to disgust you. This is more of a current Chris selection. The Smithsonian World. World War I memorabilia. Bugs Bunny memorabilia. I didn't see much at 9 that really struck my fancy.
So that's not a bad show. Yeah. So you've gone with PBS here, and it says, long known as the nation's attic, the Smithsonian Institution today boasts some 100 million artifacts. Filling in the blank scans some of the Smithsonian's treasures from aeronautical holdings such as World War I training planes and the Enola Gay, the B-29 that dropped the A-bomb in Hiroshima, to cartoon memorabilia of Bugs Bunny.
Yeah.
I don't think that's a bad move. I mean, you had Dynasty, which is not my favorite.
Dallas.
Hawaii 5-0 again.
Yeah.
But I would have gone with this on Arts and Entertainment. There was a biography of George Orwell that was pretty interesting.
I saw that.
Or there was a Pat Benatar concert on
it. Yeah, I know. The current me probably would have, like, gone between the, I might have stopped in the Pat Benatar, but
between the Smithsonian and Pat Benatar lies Chris Coxen.
It would have been George Orwell and Smithsonian battling back and forth those first 5 to 10 minutes, and then I probably would have chose one.
I did I don't mean to brag, but I did a series of outdoor shows opening for Bob Saget a few years ago, and we did sort of this summer circuit of like the Hampton Beach Casino Ballroom and the Newport Yacht Club and that kind of stuff. There was 4 of them. And Pat Benatar was on the same circuit. So she was either at every venue we were at, she was either there the night before us or the night after us. And so for some reason, I was like, maybe we'll meet Pat Benatar. I like wanted to leave her a note or something. And then the last show was the Hampton Beach Casino Ballroom, and I had Pat Benatar's dressing room from the night before.
Oh, man.
There was a large gift left in the toilet, which we dubbed Shat Benatar.
But
I'm not saying she did it.
Exactly. I was just going to say, it might not have been her. It might have been her roadie.
Could have been her husband. He plays guitar.
Yeah, God.
I believe her daughter's band opens for her now on tour.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
She looked like a cat. She was hot.
See, I think she looked like a cat. She wasn't hot.
Yeah, man.
She was a little weird looking.
Her voice was piercing.
She's got like a 4-octave range or something.
Like a laser. Yeah, it was great.
Oh, I love Pat Benatar.
Yeah.
Yes. What's your favorite Pat Benatar song?
Oh, God.
He's really thinking.
I wasn't a huge Pat Benatar fan, but
The Invincible Winner.
You are a heartbreaker.
You just sang 3 different songs.
Need to mess around me.
Invincible is very good. That's the theme from The Legend of Billie Jean.
Invincible winner.
No.
You're the invincible winner.
My inner fantasy. That's Heartbreaker still.
That's Heartbreaker.
But we will be invincible.
Oh, God.
We can afford to be innocent.
That one was all right.
Stand up and face the enemy. That's anthemic.
So some good keyboard in that one.
It's a do or die situation.
Yeah.
That's not your favorite?
Yeah,
Heartbreaker?
No. Yeah, either Heartbreaker, because she has like that like falsetto.
What about love harmony. What about Love is a Battlefield?
Ooh. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's decent. I still like
With Heartbreaker.
Yeah.
I tried to sway you and I couldn't convince you.
Yeah.
8 o'clock, Chris Coxen. 2 more nights. What do you go with?
This was a tough choice. There's Cosby Show is on at 8 p.m.
Yes, this is the first year of the Cosby Show.
I was a huge fan of that, but I had to go with Magnum PI.
That's what I thought you would have picked. Yeah. In this episode, a depressed Magnum, speaking of Hawaii, this is Hawaii double shot, claims he saw his old Navy buddy Mac and sets out to find him. Problem is, Mac's been dead for over a year.
Yeah. It's funny, the way you said it, like with the way you just said Mac's been that's exactly how in my head I said the same time.
Yeah, well, I think that's the only way to read it.
Yeah.
I definitely would have gone with Cosby at this time. Yeah. Cliff's memories of his college football days come rushing back when Theodore, played by Malcolm Jamal Warner, makes his high school team. That's what I would have gone with. But I am interested in this show that I didn't watch, but I saw it in here called People Do the Craziest Things. And it stars Lou Ferrigno segments on passersby at a construction site who can't resist peeking behind a sign clearly marked, "Don't look."
Yeah.
A secretary who takes a letter from a mobster planning a hit and a woman making a video who lip-synced to Dolly Parton's music, hosted by, you ready for this, big name, Bert Convy.
That would have been at the commercial. So Magnum PI commercial time would have flipped over to that, I think. The thing about Magnum PI, when I went to Hawaii, actually, that following 85. So
when they were still filming Magnum PI.
So March of 85, I was in Hawaii, and we drove into a filming of that.
Really?
So he was like a block away. We were far away, but you could see the Ferrari.
Truck's camera. Yeah. So you never saw him in person, but you saw his car.
He was like walking way, way down there, and you could see those like tiny shorts. You know, long hairy legs.
That's a chance of a lifetime.
Yeah, I know. And I was like, I was really excited about that. But
you were smitten.
Yeah, but I think if my memory serves, we couldn't get closer. They had the whole block.
No, that's they have to protect their star.
Yeah, exactly.
I always pegged you as being a big Bert Convy fan. And I don't know why. Bert Convy. He hosted a lot of game shows, but he also acted a lot. He sang.
What shows or movies was he in?
He was in the pilot episode of Fantasy Island as an escape artist.
Oh, all right. I'll have to...
He put him on the list. Bert Convy.
Yeah, all right. Bert Convy. Great name.
Oh, yeah. But not as good as Dack Rambo.
Yeah.
I mean, Dack Rambo sounds like a name you'd make up for a stage character.
Yeah, I know. I probably did at some point.
I'm Dack Rambo. So by picking that hour show, you also missed out on Family Ties.
Yeah.
One of my favorite shows. Yeah,
I liked it too.
Jennifer wonders why she's being ignored by her friend Scott, who would rather take Mallory out to dinner than go to a ball game with Jennifer. It's a tough lesson about puberty.
Yeah.
I think we'd all rather go out with Justine Bateman than Teeny Others.
Yeah.
Although Teeny Others, I'm sure she's very fun to hang out with. Yeah. But, I mean, Justine Bateman, come on.
For me, that Courtney Cox was not on yet.
No, she was on in 87. She was on the last season.
And she was that the whole story? Like, some people say it was planted, some say it wasn't. At the Bruce Springsteen concert, the video Dancing in the Dark,
where that was set up. It's a video shoot.
Yeah, but wasn't that her first thing?
Yeah, she got cast in the video, and
okay, so they casted her for that?
Yeah, absolutely.
Wow.
She was also in Masters of the Universe, the film.
Ooh.
Which I'm sure you've seen, with Dolph Lundgren.
No, I never did.
You've never seen the Masters of the Universe film? No. That surprises me.
I was never a big He-Man fan.
So you liked G.I. Joe. You liked Transformers, but what was your problem with He-Man?
It was just, I don't know, the animation or the voice work or the writing, something about it just rubbed me
Paul Dini wrote for it. He's a great writer. But Filmation's animation was much better than Marvel.
There was something about it that just, I didn't care about it.
What about GoBots? What's your thoughts on GoBots? God.
You know what? I think I watched GoBots before I discovered Transformers.
Well, GoBots came out before Transformers. Yeah.
And so it was a good
If we look at it this way, Chris, if GoBots is TV's Bloopers and Practical Jokes, Transformers is Follow-Ups, Bleeps, and Blunders. I'm just telling you, chronologically, it's Follow-Ups, Bleeps, and Blunders.
Like, the GoBots was awful. Like, one of the things was like a scooter.
It was a cycle. Yeah. His name was Cykill.
Yeah, no, that and there was like three of them. And
There were Super GoBots. I don't know. I thought GoBots were all right.
Yeah, Transformers was just much more evolved than...
Did you ever see the Headmasters Transformers, that last season that only aired in Japan?
Wait, there's episodes that came out after the movie.
Yeah,
and
the Headmasters
Oh, okay, but we're like, but Transformers Generation, well, I guess Generation 2.
Yeah. Well, the movies where they kill everybody.
Oh, that broke my heart.
I remember seeing that in the theater and sitting there while an entire theater of children sobbed for 20 minutes while they just saw all their favorite characters just get slaughtered.
Like, when they're in the ship and they come in, Megatron goes into, I think, Starscream's hand and just, like, blows, like, Ironheart in the chest and they turn gray.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Dying.
Did you cry?
I'm not answering that. I'm pleading the fifth.
Oh, I always admit what movie. I cried in both Care Bears movies. I cried in An American Tale.
Yeah, but the difference is that when the Transformers movie came out, by the time I watched it, I was just turned 13, I think.
And when was the first time you went on a date?
Oh, God. That was, like, well into high school.
Yeah.
Well, like, junior year, maybe?
I think those two things might be related.
Yeah. But if you met me, you never really would have known I was a nerd. Like, I wasn't nerdy in high school. I wasn't nerdy in junior high.
Did you have the soundtrack?
No, but now, as you know, I have the box set of G.I. Joe and Transformers.
Yes, which I encourage Chris to buy.
Which is the reason why I don't date ladies now.
Because you got to hide that. Yeah. But the G.I. Joe one's a little bit easier to hide because it looks like a footlocker.
Yeah, yeah.
So you could maybe hide that.
Yeah.
But does the soundtrack come in the box set?
God, I can't remember. It was in the trans... No, the soundtrack? No. No. For the movie.
You got the touch.
No. Well, I had to buy the movie separately. The movie didn't come with the Transformers.
That's on Blu-ray.
Yeah. You might have... Yeah, that's right. We were talking about making...
Do you know whose final role was Transformers the movie?
Orson Welles.
Absolutely. And what a fitting exit for a great man.
I recommend, if you like Transformers, buy the box set, watch the, it's from 2009 to 25th anniversary. They have amazing behind the scenes interviews.
Oh, the extras are great. Yeah.
It's amazing.
What were your thoughts on Jem?
Jem?
Yeah.
Jem, who's Jem?
Oh, that's all I need to know. It was done by the same people as G.I. Joe and Transformers, but it was about rock star Jem.
Oh.
She's exciting. She was outrageous. That's truly outrageous.
A little, like, I remember, you know, sounds vaguely familiar, but I couldn't.
It was like a more realistic Transformers.
Okay.
Mixed with Barbie.
Oh, Ken, come on.
Yeah, well, I see what you did there.
I know.
9 o'clock, Thursday night. What are you going with?
9 o'clock. I couldn't find anything. So this sounds actually interesting to today, Chris. Which is women in jazz.
Yeah, I mean, that doesn't sound that bad. This is jazz pre-1960, so it's still tolerable.
Yeah.
And it says, look at the careers of Billie Holiday, Bessie Smith, Sarah Vaughan, and Dakota Stanton.
Yeah.
I think that's not a bad move. I definitely would have gone, though, with Richard Pryor, and Now on HBO.
Yeah,
absolutely.
I saw that there, too.
Good move.
But I'm like, you know what? I'll go down to Video Signals, our local video rental store, to get a movie.
How much did it cost to rent a movie at Video Signals?
That place came out. It was obviously VHS at the time.
Did you have a beta machine?
No.
Did you rent a VCR or own one?
At first I think we had to rent a VCR.
Yeah, top loader?
No, I don't think it was. And then we bought one for my father in like 85. And this is one of the funniest damn things. We plug it in. And it starts, and my father's looking at it. He's not very inclined with machines, and it's blinking 12.
Yeah.
As all machines do.
Yes.
And my father looks at it for like a minute, and he's like, you know what? If this thing keeps up, I'm going to just put a piece of black electrical tape over that thing.
Is that what he did?
No. But like we foolishly told him, like, no, Dad, you programmed the time. So
right.
He's like, oh, all right. But yeah, I think it must have been maybe like $1.
Oh, that's pretty cheap for 1984.
I could be wrong. It wasn't more than $1 or $2.
The first movie I ever rented was August 1st, 1983, at Video Gallery in Melrose, Massachusetts.
Okay.
We rented Dawn of the Dead.
Ooh.
It was $3.75 for one night.
Wow.
And that was the first movie we ever rented. And I own that actual VHS tape. When that store went out of business, I bought their shelves and that tape, and I still have it.
You know what? Now it actually... It might have been $3, but then
a buck's cheap.
A buck for an additional one or something. They had some sort
of deal. They usually had a deal. Yeah. Wednesdays were usually like buck rental night at most places.
Yes. Yeah.
I used to do this thing called the movie-thons on school vacations. So Wednesday, we would go down there. We would rent 12 movies for $12, which normally would have been like $36. Mm-hmm. And I had like 8 to 10 friends sleep over, and we watched 24-hour movie marathon. Sometimes you watch 15 movies and just eat pizza and junk food and do that all day. And all the video stores in our town and the surrounding towns made a new rule that Dollar Wednesdays were not applicable during school vacation weeks.
Oh, that's great. Well, yeah. That talk about an establishment that only really lasted 20 years, but we were there for the prime of it. I miss that, because I miss going down to video stores. You'd run into people. And I remember, because it was that one weird place, like there's nothing existing now.
Where
that,
everybody goes?
Yeah, there's nothing like that. There wasn't anything like that before. You know?
I get, yeah. I mean, the post office maybe or something.
But the fact that
everyone was excited to be there. It wasn't you didn't have to go like, I gotta go do some errands. It's not like the supermarket where you have to be
there. Exactly. And
that's Friday night at the video store, just scrambling.
All ages, all different types of people, and like the great thing is like there'd always have to be a woman that I have a crush on.
Who worked there?
In high school, no, that would like show up. Oh. And it's like, you know, the
would you talk to them?
No, sometimes I would. But there was that awkward thing where like the video racks with the movies were like
just eye height.
Yes, so you could like if you were afraid, you could duck down or you could peek up and look.
You
at
could
them.
Creep.
Yeah, but oh man.
But it had to be sort of satisfying knowing that, like, because you probably felt like a little bit of a loser on a Friday night renting a movie. But seeing the girl they have a crush on, you're like, she's also renting a movie, and I would have tried to peek and see what she was renting.
Yeah, yeah.
My favorite thing, not my favorite thing. I do love video stores, which is why I've sort of recreated video stores in my home. If you go into my office, it's a bit like being in an '80s video store. I used to like seeing friends' dads clearly renting adult films.
Well, they didn't have it at Video Signals.
Oh, they didn't have the big black binders?
No, they were like, they might have been like mixed in, but there wasn't any like anything pornographic at Video Signals. You know, we were a wholesome town, Boxborough.
Well, we had Movies on Video, which did have pornography, and Video Gallery, which did have it, but they were in big black binders, and you had to go into the back. They didn't have a whole like porn black room, but you had to ask for the adult binder.
Yeah, I don't think Video Signals had that.
Well, you probably wouldn't have known if they did.
Yeah, maybe.
You had an idyllic childhood.
Yeah.
So Friday night, Chris, the final night of the week, 8 o'clock, what do you go with?
Another tough choice, and I went with Dukes of Hazzard.
Really? And you've really surprised me with that.
Because this was tough, because normally I think I would go with A-Team.
Absolutely.
I was a huge A-Team fan, but if you read the two plot lines, Dukes of Hazzard has this great thing where it says includes Roscoe losing his job to a robot.
Yes. So this was, people were robot crazy this year. Yeah. And normally I was not a fan of Dukes of Hazzard. A-Team, if I had to choose those two shows, I would have gone with that. But this is a classic. Roscoe loses his job to a robot stolen by thieves planning to frame the ex-sheriff and the Dukes, John Snyder and Tom Wopat, for the robbery of Boss Hogg's bank. Mm-hmm. A robot. A crooked robot at that.
Yeah, I know. Is there any other kind?
Yeah, and the A-Team is a singing group from Face's alma mater, Face's threats from a record company after refusing to re-sign with the label. That's pretty good, too.
Yeah, but you know what it was? I looked in there, Michael, is if it was a famous band,
they would have listed it.
Yeah,
no, this was
exactly. Yeah. Which there was nothing listed, so I'm like, oh, well, this is...
Yeah, this was not a famous band. But I would have gone with Benson, which I absolutely loved. I always watched Benson. They had a special guest star, Gene Kennedy. Benson was great. And this one, Krause, Inga Swenson, takes a phone message from the physician Benson's been seeing medically and socially. And the doctor's emotional voice prompts Krause to issue a gloomy prognosis for Benson. This is a good one. I always enjoyed the Krause-Benson interactions on Benson. Yeah. So at 8:30... Klaus, 8:30, I would have had to go with Webster, no doubt about it. To become a full-fledged member of the Boy Braves, Webster must do a good deed for someone, and he chooses a once-famous radio magician played by Harold Gould and George used to listen to as a kid. This was also the plot of an episode of Night Court, almost identically, but I would have gone with that. 9 o'clock, Chris, the final hour. What do you go with?
This was a letdown. There was really not much on, so I just chose Hunter.
I mean, I think you just summed up what America thought at that time and why Hunter was on so long. Yeah. What a violent show. I hated Fred Dreyer. Yeah. I did like Stephanie Kramer,
Deedee?
Deedee McCall. Yeah,
Deedee McCall. Yeah, I
Stephanie
like
Kramer. Oh, but what a brutal show. It was just really violent. Yeah. I remember it being shockingly violent at the time. In this episode, the brutal beating of a woman in a small town is attributed to the detective's prisoner, a meek pickpocket they left overnight in the sheriff's custody.
Yeah.
Bo Svensson's in it from the Walking Tall movies. And yeah, not a fun show.
Well, I love to see Deedee fight crime like with slacks and high heels.
Yeah, who didn't?
Was hot.
I would have gone with this show, and I thought you would have gone with this to complete the Hawaii week, but there was a show, little loved show, mm-hmm. called Hawaiian Heat.
Oh, I saw that. Let's
during a murder investigation tied to a private island's casino, Mac poses as a high roller and encounters an old nemesis, his gambling obsession. I definitely would have watched that over Hunter. There's no doubt about it. Like, what a great what a great choice. So that is the end of the week, Chris Coxen. So as you know, TV Guide is not just informative. It's opinionated. And it cheers and it jeers.
Oh, that's right. Yes.
So, Chris, I'd like to read you the cheers and jeers from that week and see if you agree or disagree with the cheers and jeers. First up, we have a cheers. Cheers to ABC sports commentator Jack Whitaker, whose low-key erudition has been a blessing during this year's Olympics and golf coverage on his network.
Could not care less.
Yeah, I couldn't either. I'm just gonna I'm gonna go with a not applicable.
Yeah, what's not cheering, not jeering? What is that?
Like, so cheers,
taking a nap, napping.
Yeah, I guess just napping. Yeah, just dying, laying down and dying.
Yeah, I would nap on that.
So
one.
That's their cheer. Is that's how boring this week is? They go, hey, good job as a golf announcer, doing your job. What do they expect him to do? Yeah, just drop F bombs the whole time. All right, jeers to Joan Rivers for her insulting and mean-spirited remarks about AT&T's phone operators in a commercial for a rival company. Next time Joan tries to place a person-to-person call, the big question may be, can she talk?
Oh, wow. That sounds like a threat.
That is kind of a threat.
Yeah, does AT&T own the TV Guide?
No, I don't believe they did.
Sounds like there's some sort of common interest. Yeah, I mean, I don't really know a lot about Joan Rivers. Nothing about her interests me that much.
Oh, so. I like Joan Rivers. I'm going to have to disagree with that, Jeers. I think that that's unfounded.
Well,
she's
you
making
know
a joke.
We need to see, we need to go to the footage. Not now.
We'll cut to the footage and we'll do that. That's the right thing to do.
TBA.
Okay.
TBA.
Jeers to KABC TV in Los Angeles for shamelessly having it both ways by signing up Christina Farrar. Ooh. Do you remember her?
No.
Oh, you should look her up.
Okay.
Yeah. She wrote a very good book as well. Her autobiography is interesting. As co-host of its morning talk show, AM Los Angeles, just as her husband, John DeLorean, was acquitted of cocaine dealing charges.
Oh, yeah. You know, I like the Ferrari and DeLorean names.
Yeah. Ferrari and DeLorean. Yeah. What a couple.
I know. Exactly. So that right there, at least as being young Chris at that age, I would have cheered it just for the
You would have cheered that because of the names. So you disagree with the jeer for the cocaine. Jeers to the demise of Inside Story, the PBS series that analyzed the media.
Again, big nap on that
one. Okay, no one. Cheers belatedly to Howard Cosell. Since his departure from ABC's NFL Monday Night Football, the show is just another competently presented football game. Howard, we never imagined how much we'd miss you.
Yeah, I'll cheers that.
All right, fair enough. And finally, I know what your answer is going to be on this one.
Yeah.
Cheers to Tom Selleck, who presented his Magnum PI co-stars Larry Magnetti, Roger E. Moseley, and John Hillerman with brand new Porsches for their contributions to the series. It was a magnanimous gesture from a star who knows the value of teamwork.
Yeah, I mean, then that just cheers itself.
Yeah, that's out of the park with that one.
Yeah, yeah.
Chris Coxen, thank you.
Good. I'm shaking Ken's hand.
All right, that's what it sounds like when you shake hands.
Yeah, I'm glad we had this talk.
Yeah, me too. Thank you. There you go, Chris Coxen, fun guy, weird guy. Always like Chris. He's a cigar enthusiast. He really is. He's like an adventurer, that Chris Coxen. And this concludes this little experiment, the TV Guidance Counselor Boston Marathon. Marathon, April 20th, 2015. You got 6 episodes of the show, all with Boston comedians in them. Hopefully you enjoyed it. I enjoyed doing it. I like doing sort of these stranger things and doing little experiments like this. If you liked it, if you hated it, let me know at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or at TV Guidance on Twitter, TV Guidance Counselor on Facebook, canadicanread.com, any of those ways to contact me will work. Also, I know I haven't addressed the marathon bombings from a couple of years ago, but you know, I generally try to keep the show fairly light. But if you want to email me about that, I am aware that they happened. It was a very weird week, and I was at the Bridgetown Comedy Festival and ended up watching most of it on live TV from the West Coast, which was very, very strange. But that was a few years ago, so we've moved on. And we did it, everybody. We did the Boston Marathon, marathon. Hopefully you enjoyed it. And we'll see you again Wednesday for an all-new episode.
That was the first and perhaps only song I learned to play in the harmonica. The give me the name of the A-team guy. It started at a high school football game. Barf, barf, barf.